pray for the awesomeness to filter out to people. Oh, Father, I just want to thank you so much, God, just for this time to come together and fellowship and learn from you and be touched by you and praise and worship. And I just pray, Father, that you would come and have your way. No matter what we're facing, God, we lay it on your feet. We just thank you that you're graceful, you're merciful, and Lord, that you love us. You are so awesome. Just praise you, Jesus. Amen.
Storage for us.
Yes, so that's pretty cool. Yeah, it was exciting to have them.
If you know how
play spoons. You guys know, is that what dangerous, dude?
I tried. I never played one game, and I thought I had a mild MI. So I went to the Uno table.
Yeah, and then they started playing Uno Attack.
That's a little bit awkward.
Okay.
Oh, they're not throwing spoons at you.
Wait, the
Diane's just the cutthroat table.
The cutthroat table wasn't here last night.
Yeah, sure. There was no cutthroat Uno going on. We played Uno.
I hope you held up the reputation at the table.
No, we're not as good.
They're not as good.
They were trying to put forks in there.
All right, you'll find a flyer in your bulletin today. Nice blue, yellow, and white. White Ribbon Day. Who remembers White Ribbon Day from last time they were here? They'll be here next week leading worship, giving our worship team a much needed rest. You guys do an awesome job every week, and we appreciate you. Hope you realize you need some time, too. So, they'll be here, and they're also going to be talking a little bit about their trip, their upcoming trip. They're going to, back to Africa to do more evangelism there. And I guess Zach's sister lives on the border.
She's a missionary.
Yep. And so they'll be getting to spend some time with them. They're going to be there in an entire month, but I'll leave the rest of that for them when they come next week. So please join us. Invite someone.
Invite some friends to come here. Hear their message. It's pretty awesome.
With that, you know what? I don't have anything.
Hey, I see Duke back here coming in. Hey, Duke. Hello. Duke must be feeling a little better. Good to see you.
Let's all stand up and greet each other.
Kids over here. Oh, we warmed up your seat.
We can see everything.
No, that's fine. That's fine. Gotta see you.
Also,
oh.
to Sunday school.
Amen.
Amen. You guys want to stand?
Thank you.
God, we do acknowledge you're our healer. Lord, there's people here today that need healing. There's people here today, Lord, that really need to seek your face. Lord, I pray your message reaches them today. Father God, we're in a time of having friends and family and even some of us going through some issues that we don't understand. We don't think we can handle it. But Father God, we know the crux of faith. With you, we can handle anything. Without you, there's no way we can handle it. Father God, I pray that everyone here today hears your message, is touched, and can share you with someone when they leave here today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Good to see you all this morning. Today we're going to talk about week three, design for a destiny. Today we're going to talk about how decisions are going to determine your destiny. What you do, the things you do, the choices you decide to make. But you know what I think this week it hit me? I think more importantly it's the choices you decide not to make. Because we can choose those, right? Amen? Most of us say, I didn't have a choice. This is the way it went. Stop that today. Whatever the world deals you, make choices. Pray and make choices. Because your choices half the time are going to stink. God's choices don't smell. You know, one of the unfortunate things about being a youth pastor for over 10 years is seeing a lot of ramifications of children that were in our youth program that were just on fire. Making a difference in their lives, go on to make poor choices. And much like a parent, you want to come alongside them and say, what are you thinking? You know better. And I got to tell you, it's heartbreaking sometimes. You see, a good student with a good passion and potential, but because of their decisions, they grow into adulthood and that passion is squelched. And the potential they once possessed, they never realized. But then you have students that go on to do great things. I personally had two of ours, and Terry's had a couple as well, go on to get degrees in ministry. Kelsey, as many of you know, David JP's daughter, is a pastor in Manchester. Went on to have a really good time at college, do really well, and it's kind of neat, you know. What I miss is seeing them every week, or sometimes two and three times a week. We do a lot of school events together. Now it's maybe twice a year. Is everyone so busy? We can better recognize some of these critical crossroads of decisions that we're going to impact our lives or our divine destiny by looking this morning at four qualities, or crossroads, if you will, of decisions that often occur in our lives. Number one, the crossroads decision is a tough decision. In its own. There's nothing glamorous about choosing God's way over the way of the world. There's nothing glamorous about it. Over the way of our friends. My wife's leaving for Denver and she just waved at me and really messed me up in my sermon. Finally, I love you. There's nothing glamorous about it. You see, Satan and the world dress things up. And they make them look extra good. And I think my grandma was a Pearl Harbor survivor. It was pretty tough cookie. Very, his way or the highway. He owned a bunch of businesses in Nevada and California. He owned a Midweek Boxing Club where all the pro fights came from. He owned restaurants. He was technically my step-grandpa, but the only grandpa we knew, Kelly Redding, I mean, growing up. For those of you who don't know, Kelly's my cousin, so that would be the same grandpa. And he was a very, very tough guy. And he used to say to me, because I tried to tell my God's doing better, and I had all my punishment in his businesses were home. And we lived in the middle of LA, and you gotta imagine, 2 million in our little community, 7 million in our county. Patty's going, yeah, I know, from there. But Will had this, grandpa and grammy had this property with two disgusting back. That was beautiful. My punishment would be to go and take care of that yard, but he didn't give me a lawnmower because he sighed. But what made me think of him when I was doing the sermon is it says, you know, think to make things look pretty and dress them up. Well, I pretend like I was doing good, not my grandpa would say, Chris, you can dress a pig and it's still a pig. I didn't quite get it back then. I thought he was calling me names. But really, if you think about it, Satan dresses up pigs. Satan makes everything look beautiful. So you forget what's underneath that beauty. We were talking about today in membership class the last couple weeks. From here, if it's not of God, it's of Satan. There's a lot of ungodly things going on right now. But here's the deal. Satan's a powerful person. Nobody knows God better than Satan. What we talked about this morning, I want you all to remember something. Satan roams because God allows it. And can I tell you something else? Satan also fears God. Because here's the deal God made. You can roam, you can do your thing. Unless they bind you in my son's name, you have to leave. Satan will leave. When you bind him, we'll leave. Because he fears God as we fear God. But here's the interesting thing. We'll say, okay, so we bind you in Jesus' name, try to blow it off, it's like a quick thing, you know. Is your heart binding Satan at that point? Or is it all burning? 6 hours later, something happens, do we say, well, that bound, you know, that thing didn't work? No, bind him again. Because if you don't get up every morning and put on your armor, you're going to be binding him every 5 minutes. And part of that armor is your sword. What's your sword biblically? Somebody. You can't go into a war just with your armor on and duck and defend yourself. At some point, you got to attack, right? Right?
Yes.
The way we attack is with the Word of God. So those of you that aren't getting in the Word, you have no armor. You have no defense mechanism. You're always going to have to retreat. Instead of stand up and be offensive to Satan. And be offensive spiritually. Yeah? Instead of defensive. You've got to get in the Word. People say, well, I don't want to get in the Word. My life's terrible. I got things happening. You have every excuse in the book. Get in the Word. I woke up late for work. Don't wake up late for work. When I hear people say, at my age, at our age, oh, I didn't hear the alarm. Stopped. My mom had a boyfriend one time named Red. He never heard the alarm. He had to get up at 4:30 in the morning. He was like, contractor. Hit the alarm. I'd never seen anything like this in my life. I don't even know if there's such a thing now. This is back when streets were called roads. But, oh wait, they're still called roads here. His alarm clock would go off full blast with two lamps. I kid you not. It'd be like, bam! So my mom said she had a heart attack every single morning. But I got him on. People, we need to be prepared every single day. It's a battle out there. But it's a battle that can be won. There's nothing glamorous about it. So even our first crossroads decision for many is a tough one. The decision we walked and talked about in the very first week of this series, the decision to submit our lives to God's calling, us to himself, how? Through a relationship with Jesus Christ. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, it says, come to me all who are weary and burdened, and what? And I'll give you rest. Come to me, bring it to me, and I'll give you peace, I'll give you rest. This decision is to accept or reject Christ is the first and most important crossroads decision you'll ever make in your life. Get off the fence. Can I tell you, I was on that fence for 20 years. Went through the motion publicly of giving my life to Christ, through ups and downs of my life, so people would leave me alone. met a pastor I really liked when I took about a year sabbatical after an overdose. He really spoke the word of God and life in me. I laid on my mother's couch for 6 months without even going. He comes to see me daily. Then I go to him and I start venturing out to his house and his church and all these areas. I really did, but then when it came time for me to turn down certain things I wanted to do, I didn't trust God. I did them on my own because the world was more glamorous. And I was used to making money. And I had to get back to my game. So I still loved God, but I did my own agenda. So God was there when I needed or wanted him. And as you can imagine, that didn't work out so well. Listen to how Jesus describes this crossroad. Matthew chapter 7, starting at verse 13. Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction. And many, many enter through it. But small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. You know why only a few find it? Only a few are in search of it. The road less traveled is seldom smooth, right? It's never broad. Has lots of amenities and tons of fellow travelers and friends. Instead, it's a rocky road with few companions. And we can only travel through the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, it's funny to me. Terry and I have made this new focus for 2014, and we'll be having a congregation meeting to explain our new vision and focus, or an add to our vision and focus. When people say to me, I've got a lot of friends in our Did I do this with on Tuesdays night? If you've got a lot of friends that aren't Christian, check yourself. Really check yourself. If the majority of the time and the people you hang out with don't know Christ, you've got an issue. And you need to check yourself on your relationship with Christ. Because we talk a lot about it, it's not what you say, it's what you do and who you are that represents what you Amen? Yes. So if I'm spending 95% of my time with non-Christians, or you hear this, I'm the only Christ they see, I gotta be there. Okay. I agree with that harshly. But are you shining Christ when you're with that group? Are you curving lanes? Are you setting the example? Or are you being one of them so you can infiltrate the camp? 3 or 4 years ago, it hit me, you know? I know a lot of people that aren't Christian. Most of my friends are Christian. Did you hear what I said? I know a lot of people that aren't Christian. Right at the radio station, and Terry and I were busy doing all of our grabbing other youth groups to join us for things, and men about the town, and all these things. I had millions of people. I don't think Chris is my friend. Oh yeah, the Spirit, yeah, he's my friend. I can count on my hands how many friends I have. They've been to my home, hang out with me, do things together. But oh, you know, and I got to the point where I didn't know names, so I had to come up with tricks to remember people's names. Like, hey, how'd you spell it? Didn't you spell it where? No, it's S-U-S. Oh, Susan, that's right, just regulars, you know. And it worked for a while, but I wanted to surround myself with God-fearing Christian people so I would grow and learn. There are decisions that we're going to make without a lot of time or planning and counsel. There's some decisions we've got to make that are snap, yeah? We've got to remember to breathe, respond, don't react. They require us to make an instinctive decision immediately, and most of the time under huge pressure. How many have to make decisions sometimes under pressure? Some decisions you can't say, I'll get back to you in a couple days, right? Especially if you're at work. And I can see, you know, hey, we got to preach Sunday. Well, you know what, we're not going to preach this Sunday. Let me get back to you next Monday and I'll let you know about the problem. That's not going to fly. Although these may be unexpected decisions that are going to face you, that doesn't mean that they have to be unplanned. They can be unexpected. Take it to God. Don't lose me. Follow me here for a minute. In Daniel chapter 6, it's laid out pretty good. Follow me. If you got your Bibles, open them up. If not, I don't think I put them on the screen, did I?
No.
Good. Pay attention to this. In Daniel chapter 6 is where we find the prophet Daniel being chosen as one of the top three leaders in the empire of the Medes and the Persians. Now listen to this. This is the interesting part. Daniel appears to be at the top of his game at this time, right? Things are going well, and he's living with this divine favor in his life. But out of jealousy, there's a bunch of political people that begin looking for a way to get rid of Daniel. They feel like he's raining on their parade. So they realize that if they were going to be able to trip him up, it's going to have to do somehow with the practice of his religion, because everything else is doing well. And these political leaders knew if they could get to him with his religion, he wasn't going to waver. They knew he was a man that believed in his religion. You follow me? Just amazing. So he devised a scheme to get rid of the king of Persia, or to get the king of Persia, to sign this law prohibiting prayer to anyone but the king for what? 30 days. The penalty for breaking this law would be you're thrown in the lion's den. I'm sure that Daniel hadn't woken up that morning thinking that a crisis decision was going to be facing him. But even so, Daniel had planned for such a day without even knowing. In Daniel chapter 1, we found that Daniel, having newly arrived in Babylon at this time, he was taken from his home country of Israel, transplanted there in a strange culture, and selected for training by the Babylon government. Nothing of his choosing. So he's in a foreign land, a foreign area, and they hand chose him to be part of their government. Kind of weird off the get-go, isn't it? Being a good Jewish boy, remember Daniel's Jewish, he realizes when he sees the food provided for him that he's going to be breaking every dietary law he grew up with. He's in big trouble. There was nothing kosher about Babylon's diet. There were big people like to eat, sleep, and Daniel made a seemingly insignificant choice. Seems we're peddling. He made a choice that seemed to be over something small to you and me. Daniel 1, verse 8 tells Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine. And he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself in that way. He stood his ground spiritually. Here we are now years later, and the convictions that Daniel had chosen then when he first arrived in Babylon set this mood for the place to carry him through this decision he has now. In Daniel chapter 6, verse 10. Now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows opened toward Jerusalem. Three times a day he got on his knees and he prayed, giving thanks to his God. Just as he'd done before, he changed nothing. You see, although the crisis was unexpected, it wasn't a plan, you see? Daniel had been preparing for it for years by a decision not to compromise or give in and defile himself in the midst of a pagan culture. Did you hear that? Where the pagan culture were. You see, I'm going to read this again. Although the crisis was unexpected, it wasn't unplanned. Daniel had been preparing for it for years by a decision not to compromise or defile himself midst of a pagan culture. You see, Daniel was pressured into it. Daniel didn't go with the flow so he could infiltrate a non-Christian world. Daniel walked with his head up high and everyone knew he loved God. Everybody. When you walk into a room and you shine Christ, people change, things change. I can tell you, friends, businesses that I've changed walking in there over time. The mouths, the actions, the way they react. Friends, homes. Now I really want you to hear this. The seemingly insignificant choices you are making today, listen to this, are determining the crisis decisions you're you're going to make tomorrow. Do you hear that? Repeat it with me. The seemingly insignificant choices. Go ahead. You got to be a lot louder than this. You are making today. Are determining the crises. Decisions. You will make tomorrow. Are you prepared for heavy decisions tomorrow? Can you react in a 100% spiritual way tomorrow? Can you represent God in every decision you make tomorrow? Most of you go, probably not. We need to start working on that, because I couldn't either, brother. We need to get together and unite and share the love of Christ and get into the Word and put our armor onto the Word. So we are prepared for battle, because it's going to come. Guess what? It's here now. Crossroads number three, the decisions. Usually a high profile decision. They could be little. Daniel's decision not to eat food, because it wasn't kosher, wasn't a high profile decision. It was minute to a lot of people. It was something small, but it set Daniel on a course to be prepared for greater decisions in the future. Those little things. Again, my grandpa, he used to get irritated with me because I used to flip pennies. Beer caps and pennies. I could stick a beer cap to a wall. Seriously. When I would flip a penny or nail pennies, he would get irate. And he, first time he'd pick it up and he'd say, Chris, pennies make nickels, nickels make dimes, dimes make quarters, quarters make dollars. I said, I have my penny, Little things add up. Pennies do make dollars eventually, don't they? So when you see, when we think these are insignificant things that we need to respond in a godly way to, you get a bunch of those together, what happens? Crash, done. You're not prepared for big things. When we grasp that idea that every small decision that we make at the crossroads has a measurable impact on our lives and prepare us for these big decisions we're going to have to make later, these choices we're going to have to make later. Interestingly, though, Satan often uses the very idea to tempt us to make the wrong decisions and wrong choices. Because we think, you know what? In the realm of things, it's not that big of a deal. It's a small thing. He'll say to us, don't you think you should have your way once in a while? Don't you think it should be about you? Go do what you want. God will forgive you tomorrow. Remember the grace and forgiveness thing? You're fine. That's what the insignificant choices are revealing in our life, aren't they? Don't you feel that sometimes? But here's where Satan misses the key. God does extend the grace. God does extend the forgiveness. So if you mess up, there is grace extended, and you are forgiven. When Jesus died on the cross, what happened? We're forgiven for our sins. Does that mean we should go out and sin intentionally? No. What that means is when we mess up, God forgives us. He loves us. But we need to learn by it, yeah? And sometimes when we're out there alone as warriors, we can't. We need a circle. We need people, Christians, people that love God, mentors. So what these insignificant choices are revealing in our life is, or has us decide, whether or not we'll decide to obey and do it God's way, or we will decide to do it our own way. Saul, the first king of Israel, was faced with just such a decision in 1 Samuel 15. He was instructed by the prophet Samuel to wage war against the people that treated Israel viciously, the Amalekites. And when they were leaving Egypt and entering into the land of Canaan, they were to completely destroy them and everything about them. However, Saul allowed his men to keep the best of them, of their livestock and other items, tools, as they captured the Amalekite king. A symbolic act meant to show his own superiority. Saul made the decision to look good in the eyes of his men, give them the things they want, instead of obeying God's direct orders for his life. So when Samuel joins Saul after the battle is over, he's not pleased with the sight of the king. He was very angry. Because he rolls in to say he demolished everything. And there sits the Amalekite king. And the livestock and all their plunder. They're all there. Speaking for the Lord, Samuel asks this pointing question to Saul. In 1 Samuel chapter 15. But Samuel replied, "What's most pleasing to the Lord? Your burnt offering and sacrifices, and your obedience to his voice." Listen, obedience is better than sacrifice, and submission is better than offering the fat of the rams. Verse 23 goes on to say, rebellion is as sinful as witchcraft. A stubbornness as bad as worshiping idols. So because you have rejected the command of the Lord, he has rejected you as a king. Could you imagine? So he took the word from God directly to him, went out to accomplish it, looked back and said, "Well, I'm adding a little meat to this." Thought his men deserved some perks. Let's bring him the king. Let's keep the livestock. Let's keep all their plunder, all their money, all their fortune. But we still sort of did what God asked us to do, right? Wrong. So take it all. I want it all done. I think it'd be wise for us to remember Saul's point when he came to that crossroads decision. And that was, God wants complete obedience. Even in the little things. Even in the things that no one else sees. That's when it's most important. Taking some of their pride. Crossroads number four is a decision, is a life-changing decision. The difficulty with life-changing decisions is that often we can't see the long-range impact of them. Not immediate self-gratification. God often only allows us to see our next steps, and then he'll reveal a little more. You know what I'm saying? So we accomplish this, and he'll show us a little more. A little more. I wonder if this guy just likes to see the whole picture and how I'm going to get there. Oftentimes God doesn't show us that. And we don't have the opportunity for the planning, but we do have the opportunity to be prepared and to trust God. And it really becomes a trust factor, people. If you've ever driven in the mountains, how many have driven in the mountains? Driving to Colorado, wherever. Cali, wherever you're at in the mountains. You ever go up roads where you can't see around the turn? Or you're going up so high you can't see 100 yards in front of you? Going through windy roads. As you make a turn around the side of a cliff and you see a little more road, until you go around the next turn of the cliff and then you see a little more, life-changing decisions are a lot like that. We don't always have the luxury of seeing what's down the road or all of the outcomes or 5 miles ahead, but we're still faced with making a decision. Are we going to take that road? Yeah, we can. Got to get your bales on that. But oftentimes we don't trust God and we can't see the whole picture. The road gets too windy. There's not enough view. Can't see around the turn. And I can make a better decision. Gee, man, that's what we're saying. Life-changing decisions are just like that road. I was faced with that kind of decision in 2002 when I sensed the Lord leading me to go into ministry. I'm like, no way. Or in 2011, when my family and Terry's family felt God calling us to plant a church, we're like, you've got to be kidding. I'm the youth pastor. I'm the guy that fixes everything the lead pastor messes up. I'm going to fix it. And I don't have to take part in all the bad decisions. I got it made. No. I'm going to tell you, God put something on your heart and do it. see around that road, sometimes we're backing down, Steve, start at the bottom, put it forward drive, and go back up. We trust God, we trust His lead. This isn't a church plant for us. This was God telling us this is what we're going to do. And at first, us saying, who? Where are you dudes? But you see, when you listen to God, and you know He's got every turn figured out, you pass one turn, He's going to give you the next turn. You get one thing accomplished, He's going to put a couple more in front of you. Isaiah chapter 30, verse 21. Whether you turn to the right or to the left, your ears will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. In Psalms 37, the Lord directs the steps of the godly, chooses the steps, directs you. He delights in every detail of your life. Though they stumble, they'll never fall, for the Lord holds them up by hand. And you get reminded of things like footprints and things like that. We may not always know all the outcomes for our decisions, but we can know this. If it wasn't the best path for us, God would call us to walk down. So here's a real question. Are you at a crossroads decision today for your life? Maybe not wanting to sit on the fence, maybe wanting to try your best to do more and trust God. Maybe a tough decision or a crisis decision, whether it is a decision that no one else sees or one that life's changing, God wants to lead you step by step through that decision process and prepare you today for bigger decisions. The first decision we have to make is to decide to submit fully to God, and a lot of us haven't. Now, I mean really submit our lives to Christ. And let me tell you, it's a choice that we can make. But it's not a choice we can keep without accountability. It's not a choice we can keep without Christian friends. It's not a choice we can keep without a mentorship. It's not a choice we can keep without relying on Christian people to help us walk the walk and giving them permission to call us out when we're not. As a unit, and I don't mean just relevant life, I'm talking Christians, we can do this together. Set the example for Christ. I'm so tired of hearing, I don't go to church because they're all hypocrites. Okay. I'd rather be around a hypocrite that loves God than a hypocrite that doesn't. We've got to give our lives to Christ and trust Him because we can't see the full picture. Secondly, we must decide to live a life of obedience to God and to yield to this destiny that He's chosen for. And realize its destiny. Even though we don't understand or comprehend it anymore, or don't get it right now. I want to have Jared come up and play a song, and I want you to do me a favor. Please. Or a little team, I don't know. I called Jared and Elizabeth 2 days ago and said, I need you to do the song. Please listen to the words. Most of you know the song, but don't know all the words, by Jeremy Camp called Take My Life. And I want you to hear this song.
Thank you.
for the one I serve. Can I say the reason why I came on this earth and died? Now I give it all to you. So take my life, take my mind, take my soul, take my will, 'cause I am yours now. I give it all to you. So take my life, take my mind, take my soul, take my will, 'cause I am yours now. All to you. I can feel you on my shoulder. I know that you are there. And I can see you paint my picture. Well, the beauty is all there. So take my life, take my mind, take my soul, take my will, 'cause I am yours now. I give it all to you. Take my life, take my mind, take my soul, take my will, 'cause I am yours now. I give it all to you. I give it all to you. I give it all to you.
Afraid to do it because there's distractions. I want you to come up here and see Terry, all right? We're going to pray with you. If there's anyone here like that today, come on up. And don't be ashamed. Come on up. If there's someone sitting here today that's a little nervous to come up because they're not sure, that's okay. I don't want you pressured because the Holy Spirit's going to get you. When the Holy Spirit gets you, he'll run with you. Amen?
Amen.
It's not my job to bring you up here and sell Christ to you. It's my job to walk my talk, let the Holy Spirit get inside of you and do the work. But I will tell you, this is why Terry and I do what we do. It's not about the country club, hanging out, what can I do to serve, you know, all these little things. It's about introducing people to Jesus Christ and giving their lives to Jesus. And in 2014, if that's not what you're about, well, the life is in the house of you. I can tell you that. That's premature for the congregation meeting we're going to have. But I'm telling you, this church is going to make disciples this year. This church is going to reach this community this year for Jesus Christ. And those that want to come along for a ride, it's not going to be smooth. It's not going to be glamorous. I'll tell you that now. Are we going to have fun? Amen. Because it wasn't fun. I'd have a rough time. But we're going to sink souls. I'm going to be trapped in hell. Jesus is going to save souls. But he's going to use us. Hey, look at this. Every one of us in this room are different gifts, different talents, different personalities. We're different problems, different sins, different things going on in our lives. We're together. What can we be together? How many lives can we touch together? How many different types of people can we touch? I'm not going to look at you guys when I say how many different age groups, but no, really, between us all, we have them from newborns to seasoned Christians. How many different types of people can we touch together? Ex-drug addicts, ex-convicts. Some of us have sicknesses. Imagine how many lives we can touch with Jesus Christ. But people, where we got to start is allowing God to help us make our little decisions and prepare us for big stuff. Because of these little decisions that we don't allow God to have focus on, we can't get under control. When these big things hit, it's like a hurricane. What can you do? You can do all the boarding up you can do all the bucking up, all the sandbagging. How many of us sandbagged from the flood? We were out there for hours sandbagging. We had 4-foot walls. They were going to penetrate my friend's barber shop on LSNO. Or my friend Adam, the little guppies, right kitty corner. 8 hours we were out there. Oh, we got this. And when it hit the roof, what did everyone say? Oh, no. They got it worse. All the bagging we did, all the planning we did, we had it done to no avail. So what did we spend the next week doing? Getting people out of their homes. Door to door, getting them in there. Telling them, oh, I'm sorry, you can't take that. I'm sorry, just make sure we have your animals. 70% of the people didn't get their animals. We thought we were prepared, didn't we? We were.
To that end, I remember one gentleman down in, just off Ellis who he wouldn't leave his home until his sump pump was working again. There wasn't pumping water out. So I climbed across different pieces of furniture just to give him that peace of mind, and then he left. Unfortunately, it did him no good to go this first time. We can't prepare. We don't know what tomorrow's going to bring. Chris said, the seemingly insignificant choices you're making today are determining the crisis decisions you will make tomorrow. I don't wake up each day planning on my mouth getting me in trouble. But it does. I'm kind of a blunt to the point person. Sometimes I don't put enough grace into my words, and I come off acidic. I try hard not to. I'm working really hard on it. I'm doing better. But I'm a work in progress just like everyone else. That's why I go to the cross each week. Actually, I go to the cross anytime I want. But we go to the cross each week to remember that we're forgiven. And it's only because of what Christ did on the cross that we are forgiven. So on the night that he was betrayed, he took some bread. He just picked it up off the plate. Looking at the disciples, he said, "This is my body." And in breaking it, broken for you, take and eat. And then a little bit later in the meal, he took the cup and he filled it. He said, "This is my blood shed, poured out for you. Take and drink." And then he said, "For as often as you do these things, do so in remembrance of me." It's not just in remembrance of Christ the person, it's in remembrance of what he did. He died on the cross so we could be forgiven. Not just for our past mistakes, but for all our mistakes, for all our sins. Because, like I said, we don't plan on going out later today or 5 minutes of doing or saying something. But it's simple. But we will. Pray with me. Father, we come before you today. Taking this bread and ceremonially dipping it into the cup. Remembrance of what you did on the cross for us so that we could have your forgiveness. Father, we thank you for this meal. We pray this in Jesus' name. To take communion, it's not about being a member of a church, it's about being a member of Christ's family. If Christ is in your heart, come down, take a piece of the bread, dip it into the cup, and then eat it in remembrance of what he did for you. If you need prayer, Chris and I will be on the sides, and we will be happy to pray with you for as long as we need to. Father, we thank you that we have this opportunity each and every day. We thank you for the family of believers that are here. We thank you for those who aren't even quite sure if they're seeking your face so that they can have a relationship with you. Please, come forward.
I am.
Father God, as we get ready to leave today, we just thank you for your words. Lord, you know we're faced with a lot of decisions. And some of the little, what we think, in our opinion, are little decisions, like the decision for Daniel, in the realm of things, and all that was going on when he left Egypt, to not to want to eat with the Babylonians. It's like, dude, get over yourself and grab some fork. Lord, to him that was vile, you. In his mind, what that would do is vile. Vile to him that that would be disgracing you. What a warning for Jesus Christ. I wish we could exhibit a tenth of that love for you. And under trial, a tenth as big, you would stand fast and remain steadfast in a sharing of the Christ in somebody. Lord, my prayer today, before we pass the collection plate into our tithing and offering and gifts, my prayer as we leave here today is that we check our heart for these crossroads decisions. We thank you, Father God, for the ability to put these sermons online so if people want to go back and look at the scripture that didn't take notes today, or they want to be here one of the 3 weeks, they can go online or our website. We thank you for that technology. Or if they want a CD of it, call the office. We'd love to burn them. Because we want these hearts to be infiltrated with you. Lord, anyone here today that's facing decisions, and I know of several here today that are facing dramatic decisions. Things have been placed in their life they don't have any control over. Or they feel they don't, they're worthy. There's decisions that we need to make here today, Lord, or surrender to you at minimum, that we're going to trust you in our walk. We're going to trust you for what's around the bend, even if we can't see it, right? Lord, that we're going to trust you for our paths. But for us to trust you for what's around the bend and trust you for our path, we've got to fully trust you. We can't be part-time lovers of God and expect great outcomes. Lord, thank you so much for your grace. Thank you so much for your patience. Thank you so much for your forgiveness, but most of all for sending your Son to die on the cross for us. Lord, I want to especially thank you today that we live in a country where we can gather and talk about God without persecution. That we can gather and give our opinions about our political leaders. We all have opinions. Lord, thank you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Please. Thank you for this. In Jesus' name.